Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And Christina, would you do the roll call for us, please?
Totally. Jeff Young?
I had not heard from Jeff either, so we will put him as possibly still coming.
Cheryl Hancock?
Here.
Anita Jagosinski?
Excused.
Kate Mayer?
Hopefully Kate will be coming as well.
Lisa Collins?
Here.
Tim Mettinger?
Here.
Gary Dunlap?
Here.
And Tom Cruise?
Here.
Okay, so with 5 of the 7 school board members present, I would declare a quorum. Approval of the agenda. I would note that the agenda has been published and distributed and sent to the local media. With that in mind, are there any changes to the agenda? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda as published.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded to approve the agenda as published. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Next item is public participation. Is there anyone who wishes to address the board relative to any item at this time? We ask that a 5-minute time period per person be followed. Anybody? I don't see anyone coming forward, so we will then move on to recognition and thank you. Dr. Mueller.
Yeah, tonight we'd like to thank Travis Kowalski. He's actually one of our teachers over at the high school, and the Mississippi Valley Driving LLC for their generous $400 donation to which will help purchase our Chromebook cases for our students. So thank you for their giving.
Okay, yes, thank you. On behalf of the board, we do appreciate that. And again, under recognition and thank you, oftentimes we recognize folks in the community, businesses, organizations that help make Holman the quality school district that it is. We couldn't do it without them, so we do want to recognize and thank them. The next item is visit with Senator Jennifer Schilling. And so Jennifer, if you want to come forward to the microphone. We really do appreciate your coming out on a snowy evening and giving your sort of annual State of the Senate report for us now.
Yeah.
So I know we offer some opening statements and comments, and then the board members may have some questions.
Sure. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. I guess, yeah, there's kind of the big state of the state, and then there's the little state of the Senate. And maybe that's what I'm reporting on here this evening for you. We are starting our floor session, our 2016 floor session, and so we will be in session next week, this week, tomorrow, and next week. The governor does give his State of the State address as well next Tuesday. This week he is flying around Wisconsin and kind of giving little teasers of what to expect next week in his address. And so today he was on campus at UW La Crosse talking about affordability and access to higher education, which I certainly have an interest in, having served both on the Finance Committee and higher education, and having two boys that are hopefully class of 2027 and 2031 of some university school here in Wisconsin. And so kind of nibbling around the edges about were some of the ideas that he had put out there. And I certainly look forward to more meat on the bones next week as he talks about it. But certainly from our perspective as Senate Democrats, we have been talking about higher ed, lower debt for several years, and student loan debt. Presently, 800,000 people in Wisconsin carry student loan debt of $19 billion. So we have come forward with ideas of allowing borrowers to, that sounds like a funny word when you say it over and over, borrowers to refinance their student loan debts, much like you can your home, your mortgage loan or your car loan, that really would have the biggest bang for its buck as far as relief for recent graduates and those who are carrying that loan. But that's not something that the governor shares that same priority with, unfortunately. So I was disappointed that that wasn't something that he had kind of wanted to lead with next week as he talks about this. But there were, you know, some smaller window dressings that he is putting forward, and we'll kind of see what the impact will be. I think it'll be a much narrower, smaller impact on people, but we'll continue to have those conversations about how do we handle that student loan debt, both at a national conversation, but as a state conversation as well. We are only in session 5 days this year, unfortunately, before we are scheduled to adjourn March 15th. I'm frustrated at that calendar and that schedule. We are scheduled to be in till the first week of April, but the assembly speaker has indicated he would like to adjourn by mid to late February, and Senator Fitzgerald has indicated March 15th will be our last day in the Senate. So we're in for 2 days in January, 2 days in February, and a day in March. And that's not to say that committees won't be meeting. We will certainly be meeting during those days, but I just think that we have a lot of issues that we could be tackling in this state, that we could be working harder, longer, and putting some of the issues that are kind of the fringe issues that excite one base or the other aside, and really kind of tackle the bigger issues like education levels of funding our schools are at below 2010 levels. And so we need to be addressing that. We need to be addressing infrastructure in this state with transportation, roads and bridges and broadband. We need to be looking at our lagging wages in this state, but those don't seem to be the priorities. And so we will continue to kind of plow through some things over the next 6 weeks, which I think will be frustrating. I know last week committees met and more than 75 bills were exempt out of those committees. Many of them are kind of dog and pony bills that, granted, are important to those bills' author or specific constituent who has maybe requested it. But I think in the legislature, we can walk and chew gum at the same time, and we can kind of tackle some of these bigger issues that we should be working on. So we would like to be talking about kind of those people's priorities, which are infrastructure, economic efforts. We've seen 2015 had layoff notices of more than 10,000 in the state, which exceeds the 2014 numbers of 6,000 layoff notices. So again, I think we need to be jump-starting our economy, working with WEDIC, and looking at whatever way we try to reform the job agency that's been kind of mired in stinging audits and things like that and lackluster performance there. And the answer from some of my colleagues is, well, we need to rebrand that jobs agency. We need to add more money to it. And we don't see that as the answer. We would like to see some other things done with really scrapping the model that we're in right now and working for some credibility with this job agency, with job creators here in the state and employers, and looking at ways to brand and market Wisconsin and have an economic development arm as well. As we look at some of the educational issues and K-12 issues that will be before us specifically, school assessments, and that's pretty timely I'm here with you today because I will welcome feedback on that. On Wednesday, I'm meeting with DPI officials, and so we will be talking about those new assessment reports. And if you've got feedback or questions or things that you'd like me to raise, I'm happy to do that. One that I had heard some feedback from, and again, this is kind of a local control issue, it is that referendum restrictions that I'm sure you're familiar with, Senate Bill 355, AB 481. That was introduced by Senator Dewey Strobel. It would not allow school boards to have a similar referendum for 1 year after a failed referendum. The bill originally said a 2-year restriction on a similar referendum, but was amended, and so kind of moving towards that 1 year after the failed referendum. It would dictate that referendums would need to be on the ballot either for the spring or fall general election. And I think typically school boards are doing that. You don't go into a referendum sort of half-hearted. You understand the research that needs to be done, how you phrase those questions, the timing of it, the voters that will be turning out, and the campaign that you have to organize in your community to educate them on this. So I certainly believe that school boards don't take referendum issues lightly, that there's a lot of thought behind it because of the expense with that. It would also dictate that referendums would need to be on the ballot, or I said either before spring or fall general elections. It would limit the control by taking away the school board's ability to ask residents to funds to improve or maintain those to schools. And I guess we have a laundry list of bills that take away local control in the legislature, everything from cell phone siting to the school referendum to some of our high capacity well issues. I mean, this is just sort of another list, another bill that we add to that school to local control issues. The bill was scheduled for a hearing in the Senate on Thursday, January 14th. So we'll see what happens there in a the bill's already had a hearing in the assembly, so it very well may be up on the 20th when we're in session. I know that day, we are scheduled to have the civil service changes up before us that day, so it might be a very long day, and I don't know how many other bills will be before us, but that one is making its way. A second bill that I wanted to just touch on was vocational licenses, Senate Bill 449, AB 581. That bill was introduced by Senator Darling and Representative Knodel, and it would expand the procedure created under the budget to allow experience-based licensure procedures. It would create a pathway for professionals in a field to apply for a teacher license without going through the normal licensing procedure. And this is something that we heard conversations in the budget about it. I met with DPI officials about it. And there already are several pathways that are articulated and designed through DPI for this teacher licensure. And so, you know, this may be unnecessary. It might be, it sort of concerns and troubles me that we already have processes in place. What are they trying to accomplish? And I think when it was done in the budget, we saw that it was done pretty sloppily, if that's a word. Maybe if an English teacher's here, they'll give me a poor grade on that. But it was done pretty hastily, and I think not really thought through, where we were suddenly hearing that people who hadn't even graduated from high school and didn't even have a degree could now become teachers. I mean, that was sort of the examples, and you know, both sides like to go to the far reaches of these things about how absurd things can get. But I think it sort of lends its point, the idea that some of this stuff should not be introduced in the budget. It should really make its way through a committee process and be fleshed out and look at what the intended and unintended consequences are. So we'll see what happens. The bill had a public hearing January 11th in the Senate Committee on Economic Development, and it's scheduled for vote in the Assembly Committee on January 14th, too. So you might want to just kind of put that one on your radar as it's making its way through both houses. Then the final bill I wanted to just talk about, and then I like the Q&A because that's much more interesting to kind of get what's on your mind. But the final bill was the transgender restroom bill, AB 469, introduced by Representative Kramer and Senator Nass, and it requires students to use the restroom of our changing facility of their biological sex. It required school districts to make special accommodations for students that identify as the sex opposite of their biological sex. And the accommodation is the student using a separate single occupancy. This accommodation is the student using a separate single occupancy changing room. So I don't know if this has come up here, or again, if this is should be a local issue that school boards talk about and discuss with the community and come up with a solution for it, rather than sort of a one size fits all, Madison knows best mentality on that one. The bill has received a public hearing in the Assembly Committee on Education, so we will see kind of what happens in the Assembly. I know that Representative Kramer introduced a substitute amendment offering clarifications on language, but that did not make really any substantive changes to the bill. So we'll see. I've learned in the Senate that sometimes senators look at the Assembly as sort of those ankle-biter little dogs, and the Senate is sort of that German Shepherd or St. Bernard sleeping in front of the fire that raises its head and kind of looks over, acknowledges the Assembly, and goes back to what it's doing. So on some of these bills that have momentum coming out of the Assembly, sometimes they don't have that same momentum in the Senate, and we'll have to see if some of these are just not taken up and, you know, or just die at the end of the session because we're not acted upon it. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions that you may have. And again, it's sort of like we hurry up and wait, and then suddenly we have to put like 50 gallons into a 10-gallon bucket of legislation. And not always, I think, sort of the priorities that people sit around and think about when they wake up in the morning or talk about around the dinner table, but some of these other bills that kind of take our eye off, I think, sort of our back to basics of what we should be doing in this state, and it's education and health care and jobs and infrastructure, and we get a little straight on some of the other things that are happening and taking up kind of the oxygen in the room.
So opportunities for Q&A, input, thoughts on any of the four bills that she had put forward to us. Any thoughts on any of those?
I got a question.
Sure.
Thanks for coming tonight. Crappy weather.
Sure.
I'm just curious. I have not really any thoughts. It's a general comment. I do agree with you on the local control. I think we're more than qualified behind this table to make some sound decisions on our own. So, and don't know the workings of politics as much. What is the average amount of time you work in the Senate? You say it seems like a lot lower this particular session. I'm just curious. What is the average time compared to what you're going to do apparently this year? And what was the reasons why they're cutting it down so much? I'm just curious.
Right. And those, and I, when I was at our chamber breakfast this morning, I said, even though that, you know, we're on the floor voting for 5 days, we have other days that we're doing committee meetings and we're working. So I like to qualify it with that. But I will continue to be down there 3 days a week, typically Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. And certainly now as the minority leader, my role and responsibility has kind of grown. And so dealing with some other things kind of off the floor of strategy with my colleagues. I think one of the reasons that the legislature has generally moved up the adjournment in the spring is we have moved our nomination paper date up. We used to be June 1st. And due to some federal election laws and kind of correcting, wanting to have the same kind of time frame and calendar in Wisconsin nationally as well, we've moved up our June 1 nomination papers to April 15th. So that's about 6 weeks earlier. And I have just learned that legislators get a little itchy when they're voting on things, knowing that they have to circulate their nomination papers. And they like to be done, out of there, and be able to kind of focus on that. So I think, I mean, that's part of the change of just a calendar. We've moved up some of the timelines of taking out our papers and things like that. Election years, yeah.
Other questions? Comments? Tim?
Just a quick question, and I have spoken publicly time again in my opposition to any expansion or even where we're at with the private vouchers. Is you talk about some of this legislation, are these looking specifically at public schools, or will private schools that are accepting voucher money also be subject to this, or is this another example again where we're creating a two-tiered system?
Yeah, I would have to look like on the transgender restroom if that language applied to both public schools and voucher schools. The vocational license, I think that would, you would be eligible to teach in either of those schools that would be allowed. And then the referendum restriction, I think, is basically for public schools. But I'm glad that you brought up vouchers. I think probably when I was here a year ago, right out of the gate, the legislature, the number one bill in the assembly was going to be voucher accountability, if you remember that. And that was AB1. There was a different kind of line of thought of a voucher accountability in the Senate. The two sides have never really gotten along and be able to come to agreement. So that bill and that idea has kind of gone by the wayside this year. Like I said, we've got, you know, 3 months left. You know, who knows, stranger things have happened that they sort of, it's the phoenix and it rises from the ashes, and suddenly we're dealing with that in the last 3 weeks or something. But I don't think we're going to have the voucher accountability as those who supported it early on a year ago had hoped it to be.
And I think that's obviously a shame. I mean, I think that, I mean, voucher schools to begin with, I have an issue, as I've always said. You know, the people's tax dollars are going to support this, and at least with the school board here, if they don't like what we're doing, they can remove us or replace us. They really have no control. To me, it's no representation. They have no control over that, and that to me is a whole different level as well. I mean, we have some fine private schools, but it's people's tax dollars, yep, going where they don't have control. And you know, here they ultimately have control. They decide if they want us up here or not, and that is one of my concerns. So
yeah, again, well, and even, I mean, the testing, where the thought was early that, you know, public schools have to take this certain test, but yet the vouchers were going to have 3 or 4 choices of different tests that they could take. I mean, that's not comparing apples to apples when there are a choice of several tests that one school can take, one system, and then a different test that the public schools are held to.
That's a shame.
It is, and I think we saw the statistics where, was it 3/4 of those that were getting,
yes,
vouchers had already been enrolled.
Mm-hmm.
So parents already able to afford private, mm-hmm, schools, found a way to afford private schools. And so then it just shifted to,
yep,
the privatization. And that's what we're hearing, is that that's the movement, is privatization of our K or 4K 12 schools. And so that's very scary. And it feels like some of this local control issues is a means to do that, or is a way to do that, because it really does reduce our local control. The whole issue for me, the DPI, the superintendent,
oh, yeah,
position, that's another concern. I think that if you take that and politicize it and have it be an appointment or not an elected kind of position, then that's going to politicize and even privatize. I know one state they did that, and Not that there's anything wrong with this, Tom, but the person they appointed as the head of the K-12 education was a homeschool advocate. So she had no involvement in K-12 education, per se.
Was that a while ago?
Well, I just saw something pop up on that again. And so, you know, those kind of things could easily happen. And, you know, we need to hear from those homeschooling advocates, but to have them be the ones that are overseeing our, you know, K-12 public education system is just a concern that
right.
one could have.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Because I know that I have some.
I just had a question on the referendum piece, which I'm worried about since we just went through, I think, a needed referendum process. And what's your thought on the likelihood of this going anywhere?
Let's see. Hearing in the Senate on Thursday. It's already had a hearing in the Assembly. It may come up in the Assembly and probably pass in the Senate. I don't know if it's got that momentum to do that. Senator Dewey Strobel is kind of unique. He's new to the Senate and sort of one of the very far-right members of the Senate. And to see if sort of just within their caucus if they're willing to go this far on some of this. You know, I hold out the hope that Senator Luther Olson, kind of a moderate who has been on school boards, will have some sway within their caucus to kind of talk them down off of this. And I sometimes think once, you know, we come from local government. I was on the county board, La Crosse County, and I don't know if they get amnesia or what when they come down to Madison, that they forget the boards that they came from, if it's school board, city council, county board, and sort of have this large overreaching attitude then on many of these issues that are taking away local control. But I hope certainly that this is one that it would be troubling.
And I know we had, so we did some research here, and we've had a number of referendums, very successful. The one that we did have fail, we did go back to referendum in a year.
Mm-hmm.
So the 2 year was troublesome to
right.
us.
Right,
and 1 year, we understand, we still, with our growth, that could be an issue for us. And
yeah.
we have been very responsible and have only held our referendums on the fall election or the general election. We've chosen to do that. However, we would not want to dictate what other school districts.
Right, and I think, I mean, it made sort of a bad bill a little bit better when they changed it from that 2 year to only a 1 year, because honestly, I don't know how many school boards and school districts turn around within a year and have more than one referendum. I mean, it takes time. It takes a lot of time to do that and people hour to coordinate that.
And where they might do it is they might have three questions or two questions or three projects combined into one question, and if they take out a project that is more serious than the other that needs to be addressed and then feel they could get that to pass, they may able to go in a shorter amount of time because of all the other prep work. I look back, having been on the board so long and so being so old, to the
experienced,
time,
experienced Cheryl, experienced.
You. But that came about, the referendums for that came about because of the revenue limits
yep.
being implemented. And I think some of your colleagues felt we would not be able to be successful in passing those referendums. So they said, you know, you can only raise your revenue limits X number of dollars. If you want to take it to the taxpayers, okay. And they have said yes over and over and over again. And so just remind them that it was, you know, part of a two-pronged kind
right.
of thing. It was part of that revenue limit imposition, and they said this is your out. And, you know, again, one or two, to make that kind of legislation for one or two districts that may have, you know, done some things that they question and aren't really familiar with the inner workings of
right.
it. So I wouldn't personally support that, and I think yeah. as a school district. The vocational licenses, we kind of have talked about that when we have our board opportunities to speak. And I think that in some rural areas, they were talking about the need to be able to get some licensed, credentialed folks. But the Rural Schools Association came out against this because they saw the slippery slope that it was going, you know, down, and that's not necessarily what they were asking for, was to just be able to license anyone for the public schools.
Well, and the bill does not require an applicant to have a bachelor's degree to become a teacher. And to me, it's troublesome. Like, we're deprofessionalizing education and teachers and the whole profession. The bill makes a point system that would qualify an applicant for a teaching license. And so I just have a problem when we start to, you know, deprofessionalize a teaching degree and what that comes with understanding childhood development and all the things that come in with being with a class in a classroom and dealing with you know, curriculum and learning styles, but also the emotional issues and development issues of children. And, you know, by no means would I say I've got two kids in school and I'm in the schools a lot, but I don't think I'm qualified to be a teacher to sort of know all of the important work that goes into becoming a teacher.
And again, as you mentioned, there are systems in place. It just seems odd that we would pass legislation for those one or two exceptions. And there are a lot of issues with students in schools now, and there is a great need for people to be prepared, classroom management, but also with some of the emotional and social issues that we are seeing happening in schools. And so for them to not have any of that background, many gifted and talented people that come out of the workforce with those vocational knowledge and background, and that may be able to, on a one-to-one basis, provide some of that education and career kind of experience, but to put them into the general education kind of level experience would be disastrous probably for them and for the schools.
Yep, so, the quality of education.
Yes. And then the transgender bill, we haven't really talked too much about that, but that absolutely, I think, is a local control kind of thing. If we have a student in our district, I am confident that our staff will deal with that on a one-to-one basis and that they will make the appropriate accommodations. And for our buildings, that may mean one thing. For other school districts and others, their buildings, depending on what their facilities are like and what the capacity of their buildings are, but to say that you have to provide X, Y, and Z may require building and additions and things like that because those facilities don't accommodate that. I wish we were more like Minnesota. They went completely the opposite way with the transgender issue that's out there, and they required that students who identify with a different gender than what they were born with be allowed to participate in co-curricular activities. And here in Wisconsin, we're just going to the complete opposite position. So I don't know if Minnesota has any maybe things that they've done that might help with this, but it's just, again, one or two of those situations that we see legislation across the state. The assessment thing, I think, Chris, you can probably speak to that more. What we keep hearing is it's just, you know, it's being rolled out, but then is it being rolled out? And
I think, is this the third change in like 3 years? I mean, so thank you all of, you know, the teachers and administrators for being nimble. I mean, that's maybe, you know, what you've had to be, but how do you know what to prepare for? And once you kind of get something, your legs underneath you, then you're like, oh, we got something new that's coming at us. So,
and what gets challenging for us in the district is the training for the teachers and then the time it takes away from them doing other things to prepare for their classroom,
right,
that they could be doing to prepare for their students. But then on the other side of it, you know, in doing we're a real big district with continuous improvement. And when they keep changing their measures and changing their measures, you know, we can find ways to compare our data, but it gets tougher, you know, even though it's one of our measures, not of many. But it would be nice once we have, the one part that is nice is to have the comparability data.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that they're working on their data systems, which is nice, but it just seems like it's taking so long. It'd be just nice if we could get a system and get one in place that we can train our staff on and then use it for a little
while. Some certainty.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, I think so too.
I'm kind of excited to see what comes out of the legislation with the evaluation system, being that we're not required to have our educator effectiveness system, but the state has legislation saying that we do have to have our educator effectiveness system. So I'm interested to see if any any state statute will change on that, or if it will just remain in place and keep going forward. We had a lot of issues with this year with the actual system, the Teachscape system, you know, and getting it to work, where we were put on hold for quite a while to move forward with what we were mandated to do in our evaluation with staff in that. So we, you know, we were able to do other types of, they gave us other options. And so we took other options and created our system ourselves within our district and moved along in that. So we have something in place now. But, I mean, we weren't able to get started till, boy, October, when you're supposed to start, like, in August, you know. So that was, that's something they haven't talked a lot about, which I'm curious if they will.
Okay.
Even at the DPI, so.
Yeah. As far, and even just one more, as far as sort of some of the reporting, and I just heard this piece of legislation, and I don't know if it's really going anywhere, but I think there's been legislation introduced that would require school boards. Right now, you have to report, I think, if it's bullying or police incidents, and you have to report that to DPI. It's available on a website if you want to choose, you know, select and compare school board or school districts. But they're asking it to be included on the school report card. And again, I've heard that that's duplicative and the time it's going to take. The information is already out there. You know, some people say this is just a slippery slope because if schools aren't doing well, they're going to withhold money or whatever. I mean, I don't even want to go there, but I just think that that's not something necessary. I want to make sure we're doing the best for an instruction with students and preparing them for a, you know, the skills that they need to be lifelong learners and to be fully employed. And I don't see how that is of value.
One point of that, what gets interesting is that information comes out of your student information system. Well, every district is supposed to report on it, but what you decide to report
right.
on and how you go about it procedurally is so different. So is it really comparable in the end?
Yeah.
You know?
And that is, we do have a police liaison officer who helps us provide those on a monthly basis, those reports, and we see those as a board. But what about those districts that don't have that capacity? And
yep.
as she said, what is the comparability then of that?
So. Yeah, so I'm going to keep an eye on that one, too.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Well, thank you very much, Senator Schilling, for your time. We do appreciate it. We'll let you get on the way so we can continue.
Thank you. Well, kudos. I was here maybe a month or 6 weeks ago. You guys have had a wonderful string of teachers of the year in various different divisions or levels of schools and things like that. And most recent was Miss Jackie. And I was really pleased to be here in the really heartwarming and touching stories of those families that look to Miss Jackie and to help with that communication and development with their kids. And it was just a wonderful reception and a wonderful employee that you have here within the school district. So congratulations to that long string of student or of Teacher of the Year awards that you've received.
Thank you very much.
I got here late.
Oh.
I'm very sorry for that.
I
went off on ice and so I got here very late. I thank you so much for coming. I thank you for the bills you're going to bring forward. I've been following them. Just thank you for all that.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, have a good 2016.
Yep, we will. Okay, then let's move on with reports and discussion. Health insurance options report, Mr. Clark.
The issue of health insurance is a big topic, and we divided up the workload. And so tonight you'll be hearing from Janice Wavra from the Insurance Center and Julie Holman.
I don't think our technology is working right
and
now.
Is there a light on up there?
There's not. Well, there's a blue one, but there's not one on the projector itself. Thank you.
While Julie's perfecting our technology skills.
There we go.
There it is.
It's coming. Thank you.
So we're here tonight to talk to you about the upcoming health insurance plan renewal. the 16-17 employee health insurance plan that will be in place. And you've received a copy of the PowerPoint presentation we'll be using tonight. This is marked as a draft. This is a work in progress. This is an early report to provide you a timeline of activities that will take place and to refresh your memories on what we as a district look at as we're designing health insurance plans. So Julie will start out.
So we're going to share this presentation. I'm going to begin with the health insurance renewal timeline. We're here tonight just to walk you through the steps we're going to take for the July 1, 2016 health renewal options. And the blue, it's hard to tell, they're mostly on the bottom, but then the copies that you got as a board, there's some boxes that are highlighted in a light blue, and those pertain to whether or not we're going to have to develop further options based on utilization. So we'll provide recommendations tonight, and then if the utilization dictates that we should look at further options, we will bring back other options to the board. The utilization data, which we will be analyzing over the next few months, typically I believe we get it in about April, is that correct, Janice?
We'll get a preliminary numbers probably by the second week of February. It'll just be preliminary without much detail, and then hopefully the detailed report will be coming out timely so we have ample time to evaluate it.
Okay, so then the plan options will be, and the rates we will be reviewing on about May 1st, and then bringing those quote packets to the board on May 9th, followed by the second meeting in May for approval of the renewal by the board. Between May 23rd and July 1st, we educate the staff through various opportunities to participate in education sessions to help them understand their plan design choices and help them through getting their paperwork submitted in time. Our open enrollment period is June, so it's kind of a tight timeline between when the board approves the renewal and when the actual plan year starts on July 1st.
This slide provides the board a little bit of a history of the health insurance plan design changes going back to 2012-13. I'd ask you to focus on the 2014-15 and this year, which represented by the last four columns. It shows that we introduced in 2014-15 two different plan options. Prior to that point in time, the district really only provided one option for each employee group. At that time, we provided the choice of two. I'd also remind you that that was the beginning of creating incentives for employees to participate in wellness activities, realizing that long term, the only way we could truly affect the health insurance premium costs was to create healthier employees. And so that was the introduction of our wellness activities. The health insurance plan at that point in time also moved to a more consumer-driven model, where the plan costs were linked to the healthcare choices that employees were making. Julie will talk about the next slide.
This is our current 15-16 plans. We have three plans labeled 1, 2, and 3. Lower participation in plan 1, so we'll talk a little bit later about our recommendations for the 16-17, but currently we do have three plans. Plan 3 was added last July. It looked a little different than Plan 2 in that it included a greater HRA contribution to be applied to the second half of the deductible, and a little bit bigger deductible and max out of pocket than Plans 1 and 2. Reminder to the board that by adding Plan 3, the district and the participating employee in Plan 3 experienced a premium decrease over the previous year.
So knowing where we've been and what we have, we're reminding the board with this slide about some of that consumerism driven health plan design that we were looking for. The district had a specific plan plan or goal to reduce claims cost to preserve the long-term affordability of health insurance, not just for the school district, but for employees, so that health insurance costs would remain affordable. In fact, it is that claims experience and the claims ratio, that is the premiums paid to claims, that helps to define the premium increases we'll experience in future years. You can see that here, the 2015 information is not yet entered, and this is the information that was referenced earlier. We use that claims experience information to determine, is what we're doing helping us to achieve our goal? If our goal is to reduce costs to employees and the employer, then you better have a data set you use to measure that impact. Because if the changes we're making aren't having the desired result, we have to ask why and look at different solutions. If you remember last year, we made meaningful progress. And we're hoping that the continued plan design changes we made last year will only enhance those earlier results. Janice will talk a little bit about the information that you see on the chart.
Well, notice that when we made or implemented the changes by offering, first of all, multiple plans, I think that's really answered some of the questions and the input that we've received from the employees. We've been very forthcoming in having meetings where the employees can come and get their input on what they desire and what they would, what they want to see in their health insurance plans, because that information is valuable, not only to receive their input, but then also when we look at plan options to evaluate their input and also the impact to the district with your costs. So when we update this information, we're going to have it actually broken down by plan. So if you'll notice at the bottom, we have plan one, plan two, and plan three, and we will fill in that information based off the actual utilization by each plan. Plan one has very low participation because it's just not cost prohibited. Plan two was the same plan that we offered the previous year, and plan three was added. And plan three was more of a consumer-driven type plan where you have higher deductibles, higher maximum out of pocket, but it was a reduction to the employee with their portion of the premium. So I do anticipate that we're gonna see the claims ratio on plan three should be more favorable. Plan two will hopefully hold its own, and plan one probably is not sustainable based off the participation in the rates.
In addition to the financial implications of health insurance, one of our goals is to attract and retain quality employees. We know health insurance is an important factor for our employees to consider and prospective employees to consider. So we collect and monitor insurance plans from other school districts, our competitive employers, to make sure our plan meets the needs of employees and represents positive choices. Janice, you want to talk a little bit about what we have here?
Sure. We looked at, this has been updated. We shared this information with you last year, and it's been updated based off the July 1st, 2015 plans. And we have included the three from Holman, and we've added Bangor, La Crosse, GET, Onalaska, and Sparta for comparison purposes. We've also included the type of plan. As you may know, some of the surrounding districts do not offer a PPO plan. They have more of a limited network, and that's been one of the feedback we've received for several years is that they want to have access to multiple providers versus a limited network. So that's reflected here. I guess the one thing I've noticed that's really changed from year to year is La Crosse School District, and please, I'm not picking on them, but they have made plan modifications trying to control costs. So they do, if you look at their plan, have much greater deductibles and maximum out-of-pocket exposure for their employees and their members. And they do not have an HRA plan. And I think the HRA plan concept has been very well received, where the district is funding a portion of an employee's out-of-pocket exposure. And I think that they appreciate that. And the HRA plan is not a component of the La Crosse School District.
So in addition to monitoring what other school districts are doing, we realize that with our support personnel, we're not only competing with other school districts, but we're competing with private sector employers. The community also asks us regularly, how does what you do compare to the place I work, which is not a public sector employer? So we're monitoring that data as well. And Janice will talk about the groups. While they're not identified here by name, you can get an idea of the types of employers we're comparing to.
The one thing I want to point out initially is that when you look at the third row down where it says deductible, you'll notice that the majority of the plans have higher deductibles than in the public sector. And that's the key thing that I hear when I'm out in the community working with both public and private sector. The average deductible in the private sector is running about $3,000 for single and two times that for a family. And that's without an HRA contribution or an HSA contribution. So that's what we're seeing in our market. So when we look at this, that's a key thing I look at initially, is looking at the deductible and the out-of-pocket exposure for employees. And then at the very bottom, when you look at the contribution, you'll notice that the contributions that are being provided by an employer are typically less when you look at a private sector. The one that stands out, that it's at the 80%, which is the second employer from your right, that's a union environment, so that percentage paid by the employer is really dictated by the union. That's got pretty strong hold on that employer, so that's why that one's at an 80-20 as far as the employer contribution, where the rest of them are pretty commonly in that 60 to 50% range.
I just have another note just to remind the board, we do pay 85% for an eligible full-time of the lowest cost premium, which is plan three. So that's the comparison you can use to the private as far as the employer paid percentage.
What does that come out to for the employees who did pick plan one or plan two? Is it? It's 85% of the lowest plan.
As a percentage? Yeah, we should. I don't know that we have that tonight. We have some slides later on that show the employer cost and the employee cost, which could be calculated as a percentage. We don't have that particular number tonight.
It was just a thought, so. Okay.
Question, and maybe we'll get to this later. I didn't see it, though, as I looked in the deck. Is I hear now a lot of companies are becoming very concerned about this Cadillac tax that's coming in 2017 or 2018. I'm not sure which year it is, but it's coming up very soon. As I look at our plans compared to others and compared to the private sector, and I hear the private sector is very concerned about this Cadillac tax, how are we going to be able to avoid that given how the private sector is very concerned and our plans are, you know, obviously, as we just saw, stacking up very differently, and obviously that's got to be a concern because that would be a huge expense.
I will comment on that, Tim, for you. The original Cadillac tax was supposed to be implemented in 2018, and on December 28th, part of the Affordable Care Act rule was revised again, and now it's delayed until 2020. So we have a couple more years to look at it, and the data that's been available so far of what has to be calculated or part of that Cadillac tax keeps being amended as well. So to answer your question, it's been delayed another 2 years. And to answer your question of what has to be incorporated in that tax has been a kind of a revolving door as well. But we're certainly something we're watching and on our radar. But at this point, we really don't know what are the benefits that are provided through an employer group benefit plan have to be included and what can be extracted from it.
But it's a great segue to the next slide, which Julie's going to go over, which talks about what do we plan on doing in terms of plan modifications and introductions, options in the future, and do we need to be responsive to this fact that maybe less rich plans need to be a part of our design, and yet not passing on the cost to our employees. Because that's honestly what some school districts, when you look at the school district comparisons, that's all they've done. They haven't tried to affect cost, premium costs. All they've done is transferred the cost from the employer to the employee. And that's not the model we want. So Julie, you want to go ahead and describe maybe a little bit about what we're looking at doing for next year?
Sure. This slide shows both the current 15-16, so it's the same slide you saw earlier with a little more data, and the proposed future plans for 16-17. Cheryl, just to answer your question, the premiums are at the bottom of the first three columns, so the employer pays 85% of the third plan. You would take that, and we can also get back to you on it, but if you wanted to do it yourself, you would take 85% of the third plan. That's the employer contribution,
and then apply that to the Plan 1 or Plan 2 to determine what the employee cost is monthly. The future plans that we are recommending, and I'll talk more about the blue column in the next few slides, but to maintain Plan 2 and 3, add Plan 4, and based on low participation in Plan 1, if it's under 10%, is that correct, Jay? 10%, we intend to remove that plan from the choices and go with Plans 2, 3, and 4. Plan 4 is an HSA plan choice, and I'll review some of the reasons that we're looking at adding the HSA plan design to our choices. Before I get into the impacts and the adding of Plan 4, this slide just talks about the plan for 17-18, which is two renewals out. And at this time, we are planning status quo for the same as the 16-17 recommendations. Utilization could change that recommendation if we are prompted to look at further plan design options. We will do so and bring that information to you. So the utilization will drive those changes.
We felt this is an important part of our presentation, not only to the board, but to the staff. They always appreciate knowing what the overall direction is. Is this a step in some longer term plan, or is this the last step? It just brings some peace of mind for our employees. So this would be the first time in the last several years that we're recommending pretty much status quo in 17-18 compared to 16-17, year on year.
Again, if we have less than 10% participation in Plan 2, we would look at a revision to the recommendation. So again, we're talking about elimination of Plan 1 and addition of Plan 4. We have low participation in Plan 1, and it is an expensive premium, high utilization trend, and low participation. We recommend adding Plan 4, introducing the HSA plan design. If this is something our employees have requested, with an HSA plan design, the employee controls their HSA dollars and has easier access to those funds. It is another consumer-driven plan with a lower premium for both than the employer and the participating employee. It will have a higher deductible and a higher max out-of-pocket. So we do plan to maintain three plan choices, 2, 3, and 4. Jay will talk a little bit about the increase in potential take-home pay for those that choose Plan 4. This is a similar analysis that he presented last year to you, and so he'll do a year-on-year analysis of wage and the impact of premium, employee premium if they participate in Plan 4. This preserves, by offering three plan designs and adding the HSA as one of them, it preserves the competitiveness with other employers. The strategy is to achieve a 0% health insurance increase. If you recall, with our budget input variable conversations, we talked about 0% increase on premium offset by the contribution, employer contribution to HSA. It does encourage consumerism with the coinsurance and the out-of-pocket. Those items are to be determined in the plan design, and it's based on utilization and that goal of the 0% health insurance increase. Current and future premiums are controlled by utilization. The HSA accounts offer the opportunity for both employer and employee contribution. Unlike the HRA, contributions are only employer, so it gives the employee an opportunity to also contribute to pre-tax contributions for medical expenses. It does simplify access to HSA funds, and the interest and is tax-free within that account, and the withdrawals are tax-free as long as they're used for medical expenses. HSA accounts are the employees to keep, even if they retire or leave the district. That is unlike the HRA plans 2 and 3 that we currently have. And hopefully it does reduce premiums and simplifies that administration of the HSA plan.
this is just a reminder that we are waiting for utilization information in order to, you know, confirm some of those to be determined, the coinsurance, the premiums, the out-of-pocket maxes, the deductibles, and utilization changes are, they drive the plan design.
So this table illustrates how we are carefully monitoring the financial impact of the district's health insurance plan changes on employees. Certainly there's a budget impact for us, but there's a budget impact for employees as well. This tool is one you should be familiar with. We've used it for the last 2 or 3 years. It includes evaluating all the plan designs offered to employees, and this portion of the table focuses on the employer and employee cost related to each of the plans that are being offered. This allows a year-on-year analysis for the forecast cost. When we fill in the bottom half of the table, it takes the employee wages into account and then calculates the net impact of health insurance elections on the net or take-home pay of employees. And that's really the bottom line for employees, isn't it? Gross pay is one thing, but what ends up in my bank account when my ACH deposit occurs is really the bottom line. And so we realize that preserving net income to employees is important, and the health insurance plan is one way to do that, particularly in an environment where increases in gross wages have not been as possible as some would like. So this is another way to provide net wages to employees through health insurance design changes. But while there's an employee impact, we are not numb to the fact that there's also an employer impact. So that's what Julie will share with you. At least this is an outline of our analysis.
That's funny, because I had you done.
What? We just have confusion on who's doing what slide, excuse me.
This is our representation of zero impact. With an estimated premium decrease, the coinsurance decrease of based on estimates of those employees transitioning to plan four, we would see an also a decrease in the HRA for the second half of the deductible, balanced with an increase in the contribution by the employer to HSA accounts in plan four.
And this is just an estimate. We're trying to predict what kind of changes we need to make in plan design four and achieve the goal of a 0% increase in health insurance. This is a bit of a moving target, and there's a number of variables that we'll be working through. But zero is the goal. But notice, so some employers might implement A, B, C, D, but not address the $209,000 to the HSA benefit. This is an example of not transferring the cost of health insurance plans to employees. It's just achieving cost neutral. And that's the goal that has been identified for us as a part of the original budget input variables. Remember, we honor input variables as just that. It's an initial input variable, what ends up happening, but we take it as a bit of a marching order at this point.
I have a question about that. Mm-hmm. Just the HSA versus the, you said HRA, but yeah. And we've had the HRA in the past, right? And but we want the HSA also, or instead?
Also.
Also.
Okay.
As we transition through plan design and creating opportunities for consumer-driven plans, we would be adding plan four, which is an HSA, but maintaining plans two and three, which are HRA.
Okay, and the HRA is the one that you will lose your money at the end of the cycle if you don't use all your funds in that account.
It depends, because the wellness, they do not lose. We have different types of HRA contributions, and the wellness, they do not lose.
Right.
But the coinsurance, they do
lose. As far as like investing money into that account that you can use tax-free for your expenses, right, you can lose that money at the end of the cycle if it, right? Isn't that typically how that's gone?
The HRA contributions are more reimbursement based, mm-hmm. versus the HSA are upfront or funded
pre-tax by the employer, and those are the dollars that could go into an account that they could invest and they would keep even if they leave the district or retire.
Okay.
Just talking through this reminds me why our employees are looking for an HSA account. The complications of accessing funds, knowing whether they're retained, whether they're lost, all those are kind of the nuances of the HRA plan. And what they've been telling us is that's a bit of a headache to keep track of. Is there a simpler way? And there is. It's the HSA instrument. But as we've done in the past, we're trying to create opportunities rather than force people to move to something. I think what'll happen is it won't take long for people to realize the HSA plan is much simpler to administer and it provides them opportunities to save money long term. But our board has said, let people find that out rather than making them, you know, it's just different when I'm allowed to find it rather than being pushed.
It's because of this that we're using estimates for numbers going to plan four as well. As much as we will attempt to educate people on the benefits of plan four, we do not know who will move and who will stay where they're at. So
there's a little bit of internal debate about whose numbers are better on that, but we've settled in on something for now.
Well, and I did the math on the contributions, and for plan two, it's 80%. And plan one, it's 60%. So there is also that incentive if they want more, you know, a higher percentage of the district contribution, that will mean more money.
And our projection is that those percentages will continue to create incentive because we're guessing that the claims experience on plan two is less favorable than it is on plan three. So the premiums on those more comprehensive health insurance plans are going to continue to go up at faster rates.
Did you mention, or maybe we should note and mention the community health, the community clinics too, mm-hmm. that employers have that opportunity to have 100% of their visits covered if they,
There's two clinics. WCA has a special contract with a neighborhood family clinic and the community care clinic. So if an employee that's covered under the district, the employee and their family members can go to either one of those clinics, and the services are covered at 100%. No deductible or co-pays are passed on to the member.
Have we ever approached them to see if they wanted to locate in
Holden? Well, I just heard today that the neighborhood family clinic is open. They have a location in Winona. They opened by the campus, and I've heard today that they're going to be opening a location in Sparta in Viroqua. So I'm not sure where other direction they're going, Cheryl, but I certainly would entertain talking to Dr. Thompson about using it.
How much are we willing
he's
to?
He's in the north side of La Crosse, too.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
How much are we willing to promote that as a district?
We do.
Like, we do that quite a bit. Because, I mean, I've been to the clinic, and it's really nice.
And those really testimonials nice. We hear from our employees, and we have an educational series that Janice and our business office staff provide to our teachers, our educators, all our staff members, and they come and we'll have individuals at those meetings stand up and say, you guys, go to these clinics. They're so testimonials. We don't rely upon that. We're also educating, sending out communication to our staff about those opportunities. Sometimes it's just habit.
Mm-hmm. We also have the brochures and the different lounges within each building. The brochures from both locations are there that talks about the services that are covered under at 100%.
So we're trying to push that information out to people, but you know, you got to hit people at their time when they're ready to learn it.
I mean, it'd be interesting to see like a case scenario of a person that would typically utilize walk-in clinics and like their provider walk-in clinics or the ER or even their general doctor visit for routine kinds of things that you could do at the community clinic, like a cost savings to the individual, but then a cost savings to the district. You know,
yeah.
It'd be really interesting to see that if people were to go in that mode.
We have shared that during the educational meetings that Jay referenced. We actually show what the two local providers charge for very comparable services versus 100% paid,
yeah.
And the impact to the employee with regard to co-pays and deductible. So we do share that with them, and then as we share that, I'm amazed at the number of members that attend the informational sessions that'll speak up and say, well, I went there and this is how I was treated, this is what I had done. and how pleased they are because of the fact that they can get in timely and they're taken care of properly.
So if you go to the emergency room with this, this is what you're going to pay, mm-hmm. and this is what they're going to charge. If you instead wait and go to the clinic, this is what you're going to pay and they're going to charge. And you know what? If you instead go to the neighborhood family clinic, there's no money out of your pocket. And this is how little comparatively they charge the plan. It's huge differences.
Well, it'd be interesting too, even the quality of care questions. You know, like how do you feel that you're treated? What's their quality of care at, you know, your primary doctor or at the neighborhood clinic?
There's some misperceptions about the quality of care going down at the neighborhood family
clinic. That's what I'm saying. I think they'd be surprised.
And when you get the testimonies, you get the people talking about it, you realize quickly. There's some perception in the community that somehow that was for people who couldn't afford quality care. And that is such a terrible misperception mm-hmm. of what's going on. It's really
didn't
quality.
Dr. Thompson come from Gunderson Lutheran and he was a quality provider there and just decided that he wanted to be able to provide affordable health care in the community. And he's a pretty amazing practitioner from what I understand.
The neighborhood family clinic now has 5 doctors that have all left the Gunderson practice and are joined his clinic,
right.
all specializing in different types of medical.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And next steps?
Can I? Yes. I feel there's a difference between going to emergency care when you need it and then you have cancer. There are 2 different things going on here. And when we look at our people and our health care that they have to pull on to, it's way different. You know, there's a difference between, yes, I'll do whatever I can do with my baby, with myself, with my family, and make a better for my district to go to certain places. But then I get a really bad disease. I want to make sure that those people, and they might be 30, they might be 60. I want to make sure we take care of them with all of this policy. So what's the answer to that? Do we?
Save their money.
You're
what
hitting us all in.
What did you just say, Tom? We're saving money?
No, I said it's partly their health savings accounts, too. I mean, part of it is consumer-driven, and they should know that they should. I like the idea of the choice. I like these choice plans. I think it drives the decision down to the person. And I agree with you 100% on a big issue. If, God forbid, if someone has cancer, they should have options to take from that, and we need to provide that, too. But healthcare is not it's a gift to get it. So I just like the idea. My point is people should take it seriously. And I think having a consumer driven type of accounts and people will value it more.
And I think the care that people go to for the neighborhood community clinics is much different than the well
oncology
visit, the annual, fitness or annual right. physical that we go for, and that's where a lot of those things may be identified. I suspect that there are things that they go to those clinics for and then are referred on to a different practitioner, but by and far using them for strep tests and colds and pneumonia, walking pneumonia, and those kind of things are saving our employees those dollars of having to pay
for
those.
I'm just hoping that with all we give our employees, when they get to a crisis place, whether it's you're addicted to something or you have cancer or you have whatever,
yeah,
I'm hoping that
and I think those are taken care of.
You think this plan is doing this? So that's the question I'm asking, and you're saying yes, it is.
You know, perfect example.
Going to take care of those people, right?
Yes, I mean,
yes.
The different plans will do it at a different level, of course.
But our plan is going to take care of them.
We'll have 3, and depending on which plan they choose, it will take care of them.
Okay, all right.
Just a real surface example, my wife wanted a tetanus shot, and to get it at Skemp, it was $300. the clinic was $30. I mean, she doesn't need a physical, and she doesn't want all that done. She just wants a tetanus shot. So it's her decision, so.
I want to say this, though, in the sense of full disclosure, if we have someone on staff right now who is going through very expensive medical treatments, and Plan One goes away, right now they're paying more on premiums than anybody else because they're on Plan One. But what they'll tell you is, I'll pay those premiums because right now I'm in a crisis.
Yeah.
If Plan One goes away, they will have to move to Plan Two, and they will have larger out-of-pocket costs. They'll have larger HRA contributions. But unlike somebody who's right now healthy and able to accumulate those HRA dollars over time, so when the crisis comes, they have a safety net that they've built themselves during this transition time, that's not going to be the case. The alternative is then to continue to keep every plan for every person. It becomes very cost prohibitive. That's just the reality of it. And so might there be someone, yes, who's going through either an addiction treatment or whatever the high cost is.
But they still will have care.
They will have care. They'll have a quality plan, a plan that exceeds what most employers are offering. But to them, yeah, my heart, I hear what you're saying, Kate. To them, you're taking something away that I need right now.
No, that's my question is all, because there are so many different folks that need so many different kinds of help. And young kids, their children, also families who have children that are going through these things. That's why I asked the question.
Absolutely.
I want to make sure, please let me make a vote that takes care of them as best I can with affordability. I understand that too. Certainly, I understand that. But I'm guessing there are very few of us in this room right now. But if we had 100 people from Holman in the room right now, I'm guessing 20, 25% would have children or spouses really much in need. And that's why I'm asking that question. Is are we taking care of them? That's all. But I think what you're saying is they have choices. And so if they choose the first step, not so much care, a second step, a little bit more care, and do they do that based on their salaries?
And I don't think
I think in some cases they do. We've talked about that the employees that have the highest income potential really have the option to elect a more costly health insurance plan.
All right.
They do.
But I don't think the care changes.
No.
Okay.
No,
that's my
care.
Question.
It's what it might cost them for
that's,
the difference.
Yeah,
choices.
That's all I'm after is
yep.
just like, yeah. please let's take care.
And maybe I misinterpreted or overcomplicated
that's all
that.
I
want full disclosure when those questions are asked and what
No, and I don't know if this is the route you're going is we're not limiting who they can go see. Some plans do that in that.
Yeah,
so.
We were just talking today about our plan and how it includes wellness provisions, 100% paid wellness visits, which.
It's more and more carriers are getting away from that and they're just following the ACA rules 100% across the board, which is very restricted in preventative care based off your age and gender and frequency schedule. So the wellness component of the plan that we have here are exceptional when you look at comparison purposes.
I think the wellness component is really cool, but if you have somebody who's not well.
Yeah, that's the one I was referring to.
Yeah, that's the only reason I brought this up. And,
well, and
I'm thinking of those folks, and there are many more of them than we know are out there.
We actually have a pretty good idea because when we talk about looking at our claims experience, not by person. That's
okay.
All very protected information. But when you look at the type of services that are being charged to the plan, we have a pretty good idea whether it's 25% of 100 or 0.5% of 100. So we will take a careful look at that. Thank you for reminding us.
Yeah, thank you for doing that. I just think that they're so worthy. And I know families struggle with that so much. So I want to make sure healthcare takes care of that.
And I know that we, at the Personnel and Governance Committee last month, had a presentation by the Wellness Committee. And I think when you hear wellness, I think what is actually happening in the district is, I don't want to say way more, but it's much more than what I had perceived was happening. And so I did ask them, they're coming back to Personnel and Governance again, but I did ask them to come here and do a presentation to the board, so you really get a good understanding of what it is that's involved in that. It's pretty cool. So
Janice, Jeff, right? I'm sorry, this question?
Jeff, did you have a question? You look like
Sorry.
That's okay.
I'm just listening.
Okay.
So Janice, you're at the Insurance Center, right? So the Affordable Care Act has made your job easier or harder?
Harder, to be honest with you, because it's constantly changing, and the carriers are interpreting some of the laws differently than the next carrier, so it's a matter of really sitting down with each one.
Well, I just give kudos to your company, because I'm with you now, and we have a rotating plan. It's a catastrophic plan, so I get no wellness checks, and if I use Obamacare, my insurance would go up 300%. So it's really a bad law. I'm hope in November that we get somebody that can change it, because it's really bad. So it's not roses
for
everybody.
Any other questions about our insurance plan here? Otherwise, we'll move on. I think they are coming. You are bringing this to Jay, to the Personnel and Governance Committee as well. And we've got some HR people there that will be looking at that as well. And then any feedback from tonight's meeting. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Then I think it's time to move on to anticipated spaces for new open enrollment.
Yeah.
Julie.
And I'm going to fill in for her this evening. Okay. Sure, roads were not too good coming from the north down this way as I got a phone call. So I told her, go home, be safe. Each year we have to come before the board and determine how many spaces we will anticipate or have for our new open enrolled students. Or students that are non-residents wanting to open enroll within our district. And so the school district home, and we will not limit. We will allow anyone who would like to come join us in our district to come join us. The only exception will be in the event that we don't have a program that would meet the needs of the student, so we can't provide them the services they need. That would be the only stipulation where we would not be able to accept an open enrollment. So that's what that was about.
Okay. The next is property and liability bid process. Julie.
And Jay.
Welcome back.
I know. See, then I'll get back to Mike.
I'll tell you, this is my first two-slide PowerPoint ever.
Oh.
So that doesn't mean it'll be really short.
I say I have some competition for you after that last presentation.
But what is on the screen is just the timeline for our property and liability bid process, and I'll just walk through the steps that we plan on taking in order to bid out the property liability insurance coverage for our renewal July 1st, 2016. Just an overview of the bidding process. The district goes out for bid every 5 years. However, this year is an exception. Last spring, it was determined that it would go out on the sixth year due to various things, including, I believe, absentee in my position, plus all the different things going on at Madison with the budget bill and things coming forward and delayed. And
A referendum.
Taking place here in April, and so we are going out this year. So we did have a one-year extension with Arthur J. Gallagher, the incumbent carrier or agency, and so it's time to put the bid out. Some work that has already taken place in advance of this timeline process includes review of prior bid specifications. And the attachments from back in, I believe it was 2010. And also we have provided our previous specifications to the incumbent agent so that he can go through them with a fine tooth comb and make sure that we are updating accurately our coverage limits, deductibles, riders, exclusions, any of the other things that we need to put out to additional carriers so that they can bid the services. Tonight, we're presenting the process to you. Following this presentation, we will have first contact with agencies. Shirley Rozek has been working to clean up and reconcile our agent contact list. And then both the contact with those agencies and a notice of bid will go out next Sunday in the paper. We do put the notice of bid. It's just saying that we're going to take bids. It's not actually the bid request. And that allows anyone who is interested in bidding, in case they didn't get on our list, so that we're not missing any interested parties advertising it publicly. The next step will be for the agencies to request markets, and those will be due back to us about a little over a week after the notice or the letter of contact. So they return their request of markets to the district. After that, their deadline is 8 days after the Tribune notice. In February, we will send along a bid packet and the initial assignment of markets, and that's on about the 16th of February. And then with that will be a reminder of the bid deadline, which will be 4 weeks after the delivery of the bid packets. March 15th, and then we take some time to review all of those, the preliminary evaluation of the bids, and create a bid summary. We do give them an opportunity to make clarifying answers to our questions in case they did not bid according to specs exactly. If we have more questions for them, they can do that. So the deadline to receive those would be March 28th, and the final evaluation of bids completed April 4th. Next, we will notify the successful and unsuccessful bidders, and then the plan is for the first board meeting in May to bring you the results with board approval on the second board meeting of May. Those two dates are tentative and based on responses from the agencies that are bidding. And all of this is leading up to the July 1st renewal. So this does include property liability, work comp, crime coverage, inland marine, boiler and machinery, all of those sorts of facilities and operational insurances that are not employee benefits insurance. So. Any questions?
Well, the next document that you had included, it was the sample.
Wow.
It's about 80 pages.
Yes. That guy is that, oh, never mind.
The sample that I provided you also, I think, included the attachments, but that is a Wisconsin School Board Association format for property liability bid. And
that
is what
2010.
That's what the specifications will, that same format will be mirrored for the 2016 specifications.
So you can imagine we need a couple of days to evaluate the bids once they're submitted.
I just was getting a kick out of the guy on the cover.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
You should put it up there. Can you put it up there? So that they can see what I'm talking about? Because, sorry.
Who did that?
Is he crying in the picture?
I don't know. I'm trying to.
He's crying.
Okay, guys.
He's crying.
All right.
Okay.
Anything else?
How long is it? He's crying.
Says, oh my goodness.
Oh my goodness.
I think that's Mr. Cruz, isn't it?
Yeah, Meg. No, he's got blonde. He doesn't have blonde hair. Okay, let's move on. Are there any questions? Okay, then we're back to Julie and Dr. Mueller will talk to us about Fund 80.
My notes. Are you going to talk?
I'm good. I can talk. You can pull her up. Thank you. All right, just wanted to give you an update. First, see our picture on there of our, that's actually our daycare center classroom, and that's our Miss Shirley there, and those are our students that are in our center there at Viking. I thought it'd be nice to see a picture of what you have been able to allow it happen. Okay, so we opened the District Child Care Center December 7th due to the circumstances that had happened, and then just as a review. And then we established Fund 80 at our board meeting December 14th. So tonight I just wanted to do a brief report as to my best estimate of budgetarily where we're at with the Fund 80. According to the state law, we must adopt a budget, and Fund 80 wasn't aligned within our budget. So what will happen is at our board meeting coming up on the 25th of January, Julie will present all of the different variables that have changed within our overall budget, and then we'll bring our actual budget line for Fund 80 for approval then with the other changes. So the best estimate as of the 6th of January, and this is with the children we have in the daycare center right now and the revenue we're bringing in, if we were to keep those exact same children in there, that is the revenue we would generate through our June date of completion. And then the expenses, you can see, are a little bit higher than our revenue at this point in time. So I'm like, okay, we have $8,000 that we're going to have to figure out how we're going to close this gap, because it is a community fund. So what we're looking at, and I've met with our director, Tim Nielsen, about, you know, how are we going to close this gap and what steps can we take. One thing we've actually have added since this another student into the child care center, and we do, because we have a couple more of spaces, and it was just getting the families in there. And as a Fund 80, we have to allow anybody who would like to be a part of it, be a part of it. So we do have on our district website information, and they can go in and apply if they want to be a part of it. And it's all based on guidelines with our space and our number of staff members and so on. The food service cost actually fluctuates depending on which kids eat and which ones don't. We didn't even, our bill was about $100 under what we estimated. So that will change some. And then also staffing levels. So the other part we're looking at is right now we have two full-time educational assistants, and then we have a director. Well, our director is able to fill in at certain points, and if we don't have as many students in there due to after school care, that some aren't there and so on, we can let one of the EAs go home earlier and so on, and because they're hourly employees. So we're looking at the staffing levels and saving some dollars in that way also. And in the end, the last part is trying these three steps that we're working on to close that gap, if we aren't able to, then we can do one of two things. We can look at fundraising, and the parents there were pretty willing to help out in any kind of event because they were so thankful for us doing what we did. Otherwise, the last option that I would want to go to is to do a transfer from our general fund balance. So.
Questions?
Yeah, just curious. Good job on this. I know I wasn't here at that meeting when you made this fund. Did you lose a lot of students when the center closed?
We weren't able to say that we were establishing the district daycare. We did it very fast, but we had lost one student to Onalaska in the process.
And I apologize for my ignorance, but was there another contract with this company? Or there probably was one and they didn't honor it?
Correct. And we're proceeding as we should with that matter also.
I think it was somewhat related to that. We were paying this center X amount, and I don't know if that was a one-time or if we were paying monthly, but we're not paying that now.
No. We paid approximately, and Sue's here and she can always help, is we had paid around $6,000. $6,100 per semester. So we had paid our first semester $6,100. There is $6,100 in our general fund that was slotted for that. But we didn't want us, that this is a community daycare center versus our educational. So we would like to try and close the gap without using those funds, if possible.
But if you have to move those funds, it's not going to affect the overall budget because you'd already budgeted for approximately $6,100 expense. So it's not as bad as it maybe necessarily looks.
Correct. I was just trying to be as responsible as we, fiscally as we could.
And if we lost another student, what would that cost us in open enrollment costs?
Oh, over $6,000.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the long term.
I have a question too. I know that I've read in our minutes that you proposed is you're going to look at long-term for what early childcare means for us here, what K-4 means for us. Like, and it could be everything, right? It could be a building, it could be
so we're
actually
I'm glad
but I really am glad that we're looking at that because I think that's a drawing card for our district. Early childcare, I think when kids and families get involved right away, that's a good thing. Monetarily, educationally, it's just all out there for people. So I'm really glad that we're gonna look at that. And could you talk a bit about what that means? Yeah. Like when you talked about in our-
Definitely. So actually what this situation has done is currently right now we don't have any community partners necessarily. Everything in our 4K program is within our school buildings. Worked with Sue Eitland, who is our assistant principal of our 4K program, preschool program, and she works with early childhood also. And putting together a committee, a committee to work on 4K and early childhood short-term
like
and long-term planning. Correct.
Okay.
And we're starting out with, actually, and we're just, our first meeting is going to be January 28th, and what we're doing is we're bringing together, we have a very nice rounded group of teachers from, we have sites at Viking and Prairie View, so we have teachers from both of those buildings in their sites in early childhood and in 4K, but then also the ones that serve our special education students and our regular education students. And then we also have a couple of community partners within that have daycare centers that are wanting to come and work with us. So it's going to be interesting to see. And the whole idea is to start to talk about what's our short-term plan and what's our long-term plan so that we know how to meet the needs of the families in our communities and the educational needs of our students.
I thank you for doing that. I think that's a very, very wonderful thing for Holman because we have so many families moving in with younger kids and to coordinate that K-4 thing. Yeah, that's cool. So, thank you for doing
Thanks,
that.
Kate.
Any other questions?
Sorry. One question and a comment.
Okay.
What was the reason they pulled the rug out from underneath us? Did they ever give you a reason?
The reason was financial, for financial, what was their exact wording, Jay? I can't remember anymore. It was financial reasons.
Well, I think, okay, well, whatever.
So they closed the location in completely.
More than one, wasn't there? More than one location.
And one in Sparta.
Okay.
Yeah, they closed two locations. But they did it in a very quick fashion with very short notification at a very, it was a very hard time because it was right around the Thanksgiving holidays.
It's not like a restaurant or some, you know, some hardware store. It's kids. But I do think it's a sign maybe that, because I do, if we can work with kids earlier, and I know that we have people in the audience that do a really good job with it. So anyway.
Definitely.
So, thanks.
Great. Thank you. Then moving on to the next item is educational options. Dr. Mueller.
Yep. Bottom one. Thanks, Julie. She's just going to hang out with me with this one, too. So the reason this is being brought to the board, this is new this year, and what it is we are required now to provide a class one notice of our educational options we provide in the school district of Holman. And so basically what you have before you is what we have on our school website right now. And we're required to take a look at this every year and put it on our website for everyone to see. And it's supposed to happen before February 1st, and that is because the open enrollment window opens February 1st. So someone can take a look in, if we go to our district website. Anyone can go to our district website, and under departments, they can go to instructional services and click And over on the right-hand side, there is a tab that says Educational Options and Accountability Report. And there they can see all of the educational options that we offer within our district. And then we are required to publish our most recent report card scores. That there aren't any report cards coming out this year. We have our scores from our 2013-14 school year. So that is currently on our website. So just wanted to share that.
If anyone has any questions on those?
No.
Okay. All right. Then the next item is the consent agenda. We have seven items on the consent agenda this evening. Are there any that you would like to have considered separately? Otherwise, I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda items as presented.
I would so approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, a motion has been made and seconded to approve the consent agenda items. I should note there are 8 items on the consent agenda as presented. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Then, oh, yes.
And I'd like to recognize a couple people in our personnel report. Actually, first of all, we do have one of our new hires with us this evening, Peggy Klein. Could you give us we're very happy to have her on board. Actually, I saw her today. And that works within our IT department. She's our new secretary there. Yeah, Peggy. Yeah, right. So we have, you know, are very happy she's here because we did not have someone for just a little while. And Greg is also very happy, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. So welcome to our district. Thank you very much. And then we have 2 retirements coming up.
Really?
Steve King, who has been within our district for 29 years via teacher at the high school. He is going to be retiring at the end of this school year. So, I mean, he not only was a teacher, obviously, and a coach, but all the events I've been going to, he's everywhere. He's always there supporting the students and helping out in so many other ways. So we hope to still see him around in that, in supporting us. And then we also have Barbara Coons, who is 26 and a half years a bus driver within the district. So just thank her for her service also. I'm always so impressed with the length of their dedication to the district. So
that many years is incredible to me.
Yes, it is.
Whether it's a teacher or a bus driver, we have a lot of that.
Yep.
I think
says
we
a lot
have long
about the
term
district.
People, don't we?
So.
Yep.
Okay.
So then moving on to board member reports and discussion, we will start. Boy, I'll let Jeff go at the end, and Nita's not here. So, Kate, any comments, further comments?
No, we have an SALC meeting coming up, and we've got a few things coming up, but they're pretty much standard with what the rules need.
Okay. Yeah. Then Lisa Collins, anything?
No, I don't have anything to add.
Okay, Tim Menninger?
Just 2 quick things. Happy New Year to everyone. And secondly, Buildings and Grounds Committee met earlier tonight, a few things working on. Spent a fair amount of time talking about drones tonight and looking for...
Did you say the Romans?
Drones.
Oh.
So, board couldn't be looking forward to that at a meeting down the road.
Interesting. Okay. Gary Dunlap.
Happy New Year to everyone. All my grandkids just started to bring home the Chromebooks, and I got a good look at them and talked to them about how it's going on. And
good. Excellent.
Those are 8th graders then?
Yep, I have an 8th grader and a 6th grader, and they both think it's really cool. And they're really enjoying it, and they really like working with them.
And do you know how to work them?
Well, of course. I'm an engineer, for crying out loud.
Anything else, Gary?
Nope.
Well, thank you. And then Tom Cruise.
Yeah, I've talked to a few of the residents about the Chromebooks. That's funny because I was going to say that too, and I kind of forgot about it, but Gary kind of struck my memory. Is around my neighborhood around the holiday times, people are really happy that referendum passed. So that's really good. And I'll miss Tim's insight on the finances. So I'm sorry to hear you're not re-upping, but you're a good man. So
thank you. And then Jeff, do you have anything?
I have two things I think of. One, which is really minor, but it's kind of like annoying, I guess. this is relates to...
That might make it major.
Yeah. This relates to the high school, though, but during lunch, we don't have enough chairs to fit all the students, so...
All the students that are at lunch during each lunch.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I've noticed that, and that's what the annoying part is, but that's about it. And then this weekend, show choir had, I don't know what you call it, I guess performance at Viterbo.
Competition.
And the band placed first, and I think they placed fourth. But the main issue is they only had one bus for 75 people and some staff and all the band equipment. And each show choir person has like a luggage full of all their outfits that they need to wear. And I know like the drive is probably only like 20 minutes, a little higher, but that's a lot of people for one bus. And that was incredibly stressful.
Oh, wow. So I would recommend that you talk with the athletic or activities director, Mark, and just get some feedback, and he can probably help you through the process of what they, who makes that request, how is that fulfilled, and that kind of thing that might help you. And then, you know, these are good things. And then probably talk to Mr. Bear about the chairs and the seating. And then... you know, you can report back next month on what the progress was. That would be a good thing.
I was going to say, too, it's really cool that this board has decided to have a student rep on the board, because we don't think about those things because we're not there, right?
So that's what, Jeff, what I would encourage you to do, and then come back next month, because we'd be curious to hear what the results of your conversations are.
So he needs to fix it, right? That's his job. No, I'm teasing.
It may not be broken. It may be just about processes and better understandings of things. So, but yes, and I think we'd be encouraged. Anything else, Jeff?
I hope everyone had a good holidays, I guess. That's about it.
Thank you. And I would concur, Happy New Year's to everyone. It's funny because around New Year's is always that time of candidates that are turning in their signatures or signing the affidavits that we have to do for the school district. And I think later on you'll see we, for the first time in the 20 years I've been, 20, I can say 20 now because that's this year, that I've been on the board, this is the first time there will be a primary for school board election, because we had five candidates taking out papers for two seats. So Lisa, thank you for putting your name on the ballot and getting that in. And we are anticipating a candidates forum sort of activity in early February. I think it's the February 1st is the date we're looking at for that, so that we can get a feel, the community can get a feel for the candidates and what they stand for and what their interests are in being on the school board, and whether we have a second one after that. You know, we have never had to do that before, so that might be something that we'll take a look at and consider. But we'll have plenty of opportunities, Tim. You know, thank you. It was kind of a surprise last time, but we'll have a lot of opportunities to thank you, and certainly want to commend you on
a second forum.
Yeah,
a second forum. Well,
yeah, two. Yeah, two or three of them.
You never know.
We've never done it before.
I know. One may be fine, but
wow.
So I would just keep your eyes and ears open for that. I would note that we have the school board convention is the 20th to the 22nd in January. There is one of the committees that's working very hard in the district is the teacher compensation committee. And there is a presentation that if you are going, that we would like to have you attend on the 20th, I think, or the 21st.
That's the evening?
It's during
the Ginny email.
Yeah. Okay. But if you just look for that, because I think that's an important session to get an idea on that. We will be sharing information with the board. Board policies and rules for, January 25th is a board meeting. Then board policies and rules for review is public school open enrollment and youth options. I think the open enrollment one is coming because of statutory changes, is that correct?
Yeah, and it's minor, yeah.
So, and then youth options, I think, is just a review. And then the next item is school board verification of candidacy and ballot order. So I know that Christina, you have the names all in there. So if you want to fold those and put them in the basket, then the board clerk, we will have her draw them out.
Cheryl?
Yes?
I thought I read in the paper something about the 16th is some sort of forum or something.
That's the primary.
That's the primary.
The primary.
Okay, okay.
Yes. The primary would be February 16th, right?
Yes.
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 Oh, yeah.
So if you want to fold them and hold them up. I think if Kate, if you just want to.
You can't do it because you're not a parent.
Okay, so the first one on the ballot will be
Lisa Cosin.
Lisa Cosin. And the second one will be
Lisa Collins.
Lisa Collins. And the third placement on the ballot?
Thomas Lyons.
Okay, Tom Lyons.
Are any of these folks here tonight?
No.
Okay.
The fourth person will be?
Richard Hayden. And the final is Rebecca Reber.
So I think you have a, is there a copy in your folder of their, where they're from, or Christina can send that out.
Oh, there is. It's on the email.
Okay. In Dropbox.
Okay. Yeah.
And so WASB Resolutions, Lisa, are you our WASB representative?
Yeah.
I think we received copies of those resolutions.
Yep,
if you have any instruction or direction for Lisa, how you feel on any of them, please let her know. As we've done in the past, as we have just had the board representative vote on behalf of the district.
Pretty interesting.
And then we should take board meeting reflection off. I think that was part of the old processes that we were doing. So then we will move. Kate, if you would read the closed session resolution for us.
I didn't print my stuff out, so okay. My sweet Christina is going to help me tonight. All right. The executive
session, yes.
All right, thank you. Be it resolved that the Board of Education moves to executive session as per Wisconsin Statute 19.851C for the purpose of considering employment, promotion, compensation, or performance evaluation data of any public employee over which the governmental body has jurisdiction or exercises responsibility. In this case, the impact of federal minimum wage rate for exempt employee and base wage responsibilities.
Negotiations. So is there a second?
Second.
And Kate, if you would do the roll call, please.
I will. Cheryl Hancock?
Yes.
Anita Jagosinski?
She's excused.
Kate Mayer, I'm here. Lisa Collins?
Yes.
Tim Menninger?
Yes.
Gary Dunlap?
Yes.
Tom Cruise?
Okay,
yes.
We will reconvene in like 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
If you're saying that.